I think this is the most nervous I've been because I think I relate to you more than anyone I've interviewed. And I think over the course of the interview, I think you'll realize that. But, you know, I've interviewed people that have made hundreds of millions of dollars. I've interviewed women that, in my opinion, run our city. I interview artists that, in my opinion, are going to be international superstars. But when I, like, dig into your story, it's the things that are underlying. It's not the overt things that I relate to, obviously, right? But it's the underlining things that it's like, fuck. And I just, last night I just watched everything.
Yeah, I'm a very complex individual.
But you're not. It's simple. Like, it's not simple, but it's, you're not as, I don't think you're that complex to me because I get it.
Right.
I get it as much as a person could get it without having to go through some of the things that you've went through.
Right.
So this is episode 6 with the amazing and inspiring Leon Ford. Bro, are you tired of being called inspiring?
Nah.
Like, has that not, like, listen, here, I'm just Leon, like, relax.
Labels are for people, they're not for me.
So. Yeah. See? That's why
I don't consider myself an activist. I feel like people use words to try to describe a person, and I know who I am.
Yeah.
So all these words that people use to describe me is how they view me.
And yeah. It's their own perception they created of you.
Exactly. And I don't take it personally. Just like, I don't take the negative comments personally or the positive. They just are.
Yeah.
That's somebody's perspective. And we're all, you know, we deserve to have our own perspectives. And,
even if perspectives are destructive.
Yeah.
It's fucked up.
But you can't embrace, like, oh, you're so inspirational. And then
not embrace the negative.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. I guess I'd be the one to be like, fuck the negative and embrace the positive. But you need both. If you're going to accept one, you got to accept both.
Yeah. I mean, you don't need both, but both is...
Is art is in the world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everybody's not going to have something positive to say.
Yeah.
About anybody.
Yeah, it's true.
Right.
I think when I up till like 8th, 9th grade, I wasn't cool. I was a weirdo, I was a geek, I read books, like I was in the gifted program, I went on summer camp. So when I finally got cool in like 10th grade, like it was dope. I'd be at the end of the hallway, girls walking past, you know, my swag started to develop, I was playing sports. But I think something complex when I was younger of like wanting to be liked,
yeah,
is still here. I'm 32. I think it still is like everything that I hear about myself that's not positive, I kind of want to change that. And it's fucked up because as I get older, I start realizing that you can't change it. You got to accept it.
Exactly. My last week, during my session with my therapist, she said, stop accepting things that don't belong to you.
Yeah.
And be kind to yourself. And what she was referring to is like, I can be critical of myself sometimes.
Right.
And really overcritical. And so she said, well, if somebody said you were stupid, would you like analyze like, well, am I stupid?
Right. I've done it.
But it's like, yeah, you shouldn't do it. Right.
Yeah, I've
like,
done it in the past, though, but I get what you're saying.
So it's like, be kind to yourself.
Yeah.
And this is like, I was talking about this on live last week. Like,
I watched that whole live. That shit was crazy.
Yeah. It's like, yo, say, like, positive affirmations to yourself.
Yeah.
Every day.
Yeah.
Right? So you can, like, really, you know, accept who you are and combat some of those negative things that people may say.
Yeah. So I kind of, like, as I started watching, like, everything and then reading everything, and, like, I'm one of those guys, like, and, of course, you're probably, like, way busier than I am, but I have so many things going on in my life. That kind of put things off to the last minute. And then I try and have free time to do things that relaxes me, like play Call of Duty.
Right.
that's my thing. But as this interview approached, of course, I knew some of the things that, you know, everybody knows about your story. But I try and approach every story a little bit differently. And for me, as I started researching everything and get my hands on and listen to everything, a question started to form in my mind of, one, how you handle yourself and how you speak and structure your sentences are unlike 90%, 95% of the people I've ever dealt with. And the 5% of the people that I deal with who are so thoughtful and thought-provoking in the way they structure their thoughts and deliver them into the world are in some of the highest levels of their particular industry, right? Which made me think, was it the incident that happened November 11th, 2012, that changed you so much, that you grew so much, that you were able to become this amazing person who was a master of delivering his thoughts, whether they were thoughts about depression, motivation, inspiration, whatever the case was? And then I started thinking, well, who was Leon Ford before November 11th, correct?
Right.
Yeah. I want to know, like, that's what I started thinking, like, nah, it, what, like, it was the moment for sure. And all moments that are like that, positive and negative, do change us. Right. But, like, what the fuck were you like before then? Like, how were you? Like, how did you live your life? What did you like to do for fun? Like, did you have girlfriends? Like, were you the man? Like, what school did you, like, I want to know, like, the shit before. Like, I want to start, like, before. Like,
yeah, I had a bunch of girlfriends.
Oh, you was lit.
Yeah.
You was lit. All right.
I had a bunch of girlfriends. I was popular, very popular.
Okay.
And I always liked money.
Okay.
Yeah, so.
So you was always kind of, like, charismatic, because you have that trait about you.
Yeah, so, like, I say fifth grade, I had my own candy bar business.
Oh, snap.
Yeah, I remember the school, like, we had a fundraiser, and I sold all these candy bars for the school, and I remember I had to get the money back to the school.
Yeah, you was pissed.
And I was like, hold up.
He was
like,
pissed.
I just made, like, $200.
Yeah, like, on the come school. Up.
And I'm like, Ma, this field trip, I think it was going to Kennywood. I'm like, yeah, the tickets were only, like, $18. Like, and I just made them, like, $200. Like,
yeah.
It don't make sense. And my mom, like,
the field trip was, like, $18. Yes, like, I know the price. I've been to the Science Center. Like, this is corny.
Yeah, so my mom ended up finding the company that the school got the candy bars from.
Oh, y'all did a deep dive on the candy bar company?
Yeah.
Oh,
like,
my God.
It's, I started, like, buying the boxes. And so I remember you got 208 candy bars for, like, $104.
Yeah.
So you pretty much doubled your money. And they came in the boxes.
So the school was running a scam.
Basically. Yeah, basically.
That's crazy. I never knew that.
And so
my dumb ass sold candy bars.
For the school, like, yeah, I was like, yeah, I need all this loot. Like,
no, that's crazy.
And so I started selling those candy bars, and I had, like, all my cousins and my homies selling them with me. And I would keep all the money, but they would get the tips.
Yeah.
But the good thing about tips is, like, you know, when you're, like, 12, 13 years
it's
old.
It's lit.
Like, yeah, you're getting, like, $20 tips from, like, the hustlers in the neighborhood. Like,
yeah. Oh, so you cool.
Yeah, so everybody was eating, right? And so that was, like, 5th, 6th grade. 7th and 8th grade, I was selling shoe mats. And so, yeah. So, like, shoe mats are, like, knockoff tennis shoes.
Okay.
So
for, I was wondering, like,
yeah,
all right, cool.
For people who don't know. And so, like, all the Jordans and Air Forces that didn't come out yet.
Oh, you were selling them? You was getting them off?
Yeah.
And they were hype? Yeah. Oh, you got the new joints? Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So, like, my uncle used to go to New York all the time, and I used to buy cases of shoes off of him.
And you was doing this in 8th grade?
Yeah, like 7th and 8th.
That's crazy.
And so, like, yeah, I was doing that, selling to, like, all my classmates and stuff. And, like,
so you was always, like, a entrepreneur, for real?
Yeah. And then, like, when I kind of started to lose myself,
yeah,
was, like, 8th grade, right?
Isn't it always around that time? I said I got cool around 9th grade, right?
Yeah, so, and it was a combination of, like, girls, and my sister passed away when I was in the 8th grade.
For real?
Yeah, so she was 10 years old. She was hit by a truck.
Oh, my God.
And I know after that, it's like school became more of a place of, like, refuge, for real.
Yeah.
Because home was, like,
so, a reminder.
So heavy, yeah, like, you know.
Yeah, it was heavy, yeah.
And so I started to, like,
I didn't know you lost your sister.
Yeah, 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 man.
What was her name?
Liana.
She was a twin. She wasn't a twin.
Yeah, she was. Nah, we were 3 years apart. But
Liana.
Yeah, we were basically twins. Yeah, man.
I'm sorry, bro.
Yeah, it was definitely hard. And that's when like I started to skip class all the time, and I don't know. Then I started to sell weed.
Yeah.
In ninth grade, and I got really good and at selling.
Who didn't sell a little bit of weed and got a little good at it?
Yeah, and
it's one of those things that happen.
Yeah, and so that just set me on a different path through like high school.
You didn't play any sports?
I used to box.
That's, you know what? And when I watched Leon last night for the second time, I was just questioning myself, like, what was the boxing reference?
Yeah, I used
to. And I said, the only way, he's not a person that just puts things in there. So the only way it makes sense is either it's a sport that he loves or it's a sport that he used to do.
Yeah, I used
to. So you could fight. You could probably fight now.
Yeah.
I seen you put up the weight the other day. I said, oh, this boy's still like in tip top condition.
Yeah.
You're not bullshitting.
Yeah, I used to fight a lot.
For real?
Yeah. But I wasn't a troublemaker though.
No, but you fought like in the ring.
Yeah. No, I fought in the ring, but
outside the ring?
In the neighborhood too.
Well, you probably like me, you never was the one to start it, but
yeah.
Like you exclamation point.
Yeah.
Like I'll end it.
Most of the fights that I had, I knocked the person out.
That's crazy.
Yeah, I think the only person I didn't knock out was one of my boys. Yeah.
It was one of them love type of fights.
Yeah, we fought a lot.
That's how it happens. Yeah, it happens with your homies.
Yeah, he got me a couple of times. I got him a couple of times. You know, Soldier Beast.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
So, like, he could fight. Yeah, we used to get it on.
So I take it that you had a close set of friends growing up. Where are you from?
Yeah. So I'm from Garfield.
Okay.
But I live all over the city.
Every time when you said Garfield, I keep hearing like a Ratchet Girl's voice in my head. Garfield! I'm sorry, bro. Like, Garfield! My bad. All right, go ahead. Garfield.
I'm from Garfield, but, you know, I lived in everywhere.
Yeah.
So that's why I always claim the whole East Side.
East Side, yeah, for sure. I'm East Side, dude.
But yeah, I play football for the Gators.
Oh, okay.
I also play football for Lincoln too. So.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's like.
Oh, that's what's up. Yeah. That's crazy. When you graduated high school.
Yeah.
You never thought about college.
And when I'm
sitting here, I'm thinking about the timeline. You were 19 when that event happened, so you're kind of like a year or 2 years fresh out of high school.
1 year.
1 year.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's crazy.
I was very intelligent, and I think...
that's what I was curious. Like, what was your grades? Like, I just keep... Bro, like, there's a lot of people that go through things similar.
Right.
Not the same. And it changes them, either super negative or super positive.
Right.
But you're just an intelligent motherfucker. And as I analyze everything, I'm like, God. Like, God damn.
Yeah, I always had good grades.
Yeah.
But school wasn't a challenge for me.
Yeah.
Like now I think back on it.
Yeah.
Like I was like a class clown and I used to skip class a lot, but I always passed with good grades.
Yeah.
So I would do my work and then skip.
Yeah.
Right. And so like I never really liked the idea of traditional education.
Did you take your SATs? No.
I don't think I took my SATs. Yeah, it was just like I was making a lot of money. Like I wasn't like just
No, I get it.
Like I was like I was young. And
if you charismatic, you getting girls, and you start doing some things in 9th, 10th, it usually that's how it happens.
Yeah. So
I had 3 cars in my senior year.
Yeah.
Back to back to back.
Same.
But way. I'm in Penn Hills though. I was in Penn Hills. Thought I was the shit.
Yeah. It was like so. It was like school was kind of like all right. Like I was more. I had more of an entrepreneurial mindset.
Yeah.
And then like. Think I had to go to college.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I always wonder what my life would be like if I did go to college.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I started thinking about that. Like, damn, what would this, like if his life would have went in a different direction. Because when I started thinking about how your life was beforehand.
Right.
And I knew there was things there that was still your core. It had to have been. This shit thing just, like it changed you, but there was still core things within you. And I think, and this is how I think I started like examining putting my life comparable to yours and how we kind of relate. And a lot of people say, you know, Mike, you've changed, or Mike, you're different. And I argue that I'm the same person I was 16 years ago when I was at 16, when I was 16.
Right.
But I progressed over 15 years. I'd be a dummy not to.
Exactly.
I've went through tragic things. It did it change me for the better? Yes, but I'm still the core person. And as I started looking at like how people perceive me, I started looking at you and saying, well, who was he when he was 15? You know, because it seemed like everything I fucking seen, it was like your life started at November 11th.
Yeah, it's weird.
It was just like, dog. It was like, I get it. Like, and I'm not, when I say, I'm not underplaying or undervaluing what happened.
Right.
But for me, it was like, I don't think that's all that defined.
Yeah, because Leon, if it wasn't for who I was,
then you wouldn't have been able to have the oomph.
Yeah, because, you know, I really, you know, changed the culture in Pittsburgh after I got shot.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember when Jordan Miles was beat up in Homewood.
Yeah.
And, like we were, like, we didn't protest for him.
Yeah.
And we knew, like,
yeah,
we were so culturally conditioned to get beat up by police officers or get pulled over. It was just like, yo. And then he didn't hang out with us. So
yeah, no one cares.
He went to Kappa. So, like, all the churches and stuff supported him. But the streets, the neighborhoods.
They didn't support him.
Nobody really supported him.
And that's the one thing I kind of, like, I say that you did. And that I kind of hate as a culture. I think we're kind of like social media warriors. And I think for you, it was like people came out. They stood on what they said. Right. And I sometimes wish that people would stand more on what they say like they did for you. Like,
it's all about relationships, though.
Yeah.
Right? And so when I have, like, cousins in, like, every neighborhood.
Yeah.
Right? Or homies in every neighborhood who I did business with before I got shot.
Yeah.
They respect me. They respect my family.
Yeah.
And they came out because they're like, damn, like,
this is fucked up.
Yeah, and we rock with Leon.
Like, yeah.
You know what I mean? That's the homie, right? And so it was more of, that's the homie. Like, Leon is a good dude.
Yeah.
It was more of that than, like, yo, this is an injustice.
Injustice,
so
yeah.
It was a
combination of both.
Exactly.
And then I think you set the trend as like, all right, nothing else will be tolerated in this city. And then the next thing that happened, people stood up.
Exactly.
I kind of want to, like, get back to, like, you know, you get out of high school and, like, you're doing your thing, entrepreneur, and, you know, the things that are legal now were illegal back then.
Absolutely.
Funny how that worked, right?
Yeah. And it's still
it's still
illegal.
Yeah.
To an extent.
But, it's just mind-boggling to me.
Yeah.
It's one of the things I've seen. You say that struck me as odd, and I think I seen this in the live, was, you know, I don't think we have to go through the particulars of what happened that night. I think you're probably tired of telling that story. Deep down inside, you might be tired, but you won't say it out loud.
Yeah.
Oh, I'll speak for you. I would be tired. But you said something that struck me was people was like, well, it looked like you pulled off.
Yeah.
And that right there is, like, crazy. Like, the thought of, like, the people you love or your peers or the people in your environment, even if it's only 30-40% questioning you about what happened that night when you almost died.
It's a Pittsburgh mentality, though.
Yeah.
It's only black folks in Pittsburgh that ask me that.
Yeah.
Like, black folks in Philadelphia.
But they don't know you. I think the reason why I say it's not Pittsburgh, I'm trying to get away from Pittsburgh.
Hold on.
All right, go ahead.
Because I literally tell my story differently.
Yeah.
In Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
Well, I did in the past.
Yeah.
In Pittsburgh, then I would in Philadelphia or Baltimore or Oakland, California.
Tell me about that. What you mean?
Pittsburgh, people are passive, bro.
Yeah. You think so?
They are, bro.
Oh my God!
If you're an alpha male in Pittsburgh,
yeah,
you're looked at like you're a monster, bro.
That's true, but it's like, I feel like it's like that in any city, though.
Bro, look. When I tell my story in Pittsburgh,
yeah,
like in the past, like, so this is while I was still going through court,
yeah,
right? So the whole case was like, well, did you pull off or did you not?
Yeah.
When I would get to the pull off, I'd be like, yeah, I don't know what happened.
Yeah,
bro. That's in Pittsburgh. In Oakland, I would tell that story.
Yeah.
They were like, yo, Yeah, and he smashed off, bro. I would have did the same thing. Like, you feel me?
Yeah.
Same thing in Philadelphia. They were like, yo, I would have, like, we know, like, yeah. I would have pulled off too. Like, in Pittsburgh, literally men,
yeah,
you know, that I respect, and women, we're like, yo, why don't you just let them beat you up?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I don't think it's, here's
and,
the thing.
And on top of that, I had a lawyer from Philadelphia, right?
Yeah.
And so he's like, he was a white guy, you know, and he's downtown Pittsburgh. So he's like, yo, the energy in the city is different. Like,
yeah.
When I walk down the street downtown, black people like move out my way.
Yeah, in Pittsburgh.
In Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
He's like, bro, it's not like that. Like, they don't even make eye contact with me here in Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
Like, we had a conversation about this, bro.
Yeah.
And he's like, yeah, it's not like that in Philly. And I seen a difference in how I had to tell my story. Like, and I'm talking about, like, everyday people. You know what I'm saying? I'm not talking about the folks in the streets,
yeah,
who, you know, are already surviving. So they're like,
so they're used to it.
They're used to it. So, like, when you got somebody who's surviving,
mm-hmm,
they're already like, what's up?
Yeah, for sure.
You feel me? But, like the nonprofit organizations, the churches.
The blue collars.
Yeah, bro. Most of them are very passive, bro.
Yeah. Damn. I want to argue it, but, I mean, only you would really know.
Yeah, I mean.
But.
And they, like, people in Pittsburgh, bro, they're not real confrontational. If they got a problem with you, they'll go talk about somebody, talk about you to somebody else,
mm-hmm,
and like they won't rock with you.
Yeah.
How many times have you done business with people and in private they're like, yo, I don't really rock with them, bro. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Many times.
But then, you know, at an event, they're like, oh, what's up? Like,
many times.
You feel
many,
me?
Many bro, times, like, bro.
It's so.
But that's the reason why I try. Like, if I have a problem, I'll say it. I'll say it online too.
Yeah.
Or like, oh.
But you left the city though.
Yeah, but let me tell
you. All right, so
let me tell you.
Two things. All right,
go ahead.
You left the city.
Yeah.
So the energy that you bring, like the way you think, is different.
Yeah, of course.
Most of the black folks that are in positions of power that are not passive,
mm-hmm,
left the city, bro.
Yeah.
For at least a year.
But you gain your position and your perspective, not position, your perspective and your wealth of knowledge that was already built on foundation through the fight that you had here in the city. In particular, you say, and I don't want to misquote you, I broke my lease. The next day I broke my lease.
Yeah.
And I left. And I left not because I was running away from responsibility. I left because from 19 to 26, I was fighting. So when I took from that, and we're going to revisit that topic, but when right. I took from that was, you need to get out. Like, and this was like one of your first times you was able to leave the city. So no, I get what you're saying.
So no. All growing right. up, I always left the city.
Oh, yeah. You was traveling.
Bro, I'd start flying by myself when I was 8 years old.
Okay.
To visit my grandfather
okay.
in Massachusetts.
Okay.
You feel me? My mom would take us to Miami or Atlanta or Jamaica.
So you was like, okay.
So I was exposed to these different things, and that is why when I got fed up with the city, it was nothing for me to go to Europe by myself.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, it was nothing for me to just.
I love that shit.
Just go, because I was exposed to that and I knew it was possible.
Yeah.
Right? Most people, like, bro, I know people from the hill who don't know how to get to Homewood, bro.
Yeah.
I know people from Northview who don't know how to get to Larmer or East Liberty.
Right? Oh, I still like using my maps, but all right. Yeah.
Yeah, but like,
yeah,
it's like, yo, Pittsburgh, like, we got to expose each other to different things, because
yeah,
when we don't, you know, we get so trapped in this mindset.
That's true.
And, bro, the people in Pittsburgh who are doing great things are people who left the city, bro.
Yeah, I mean, I get that. I give you that. But I also say, like as such as you, I've been around the world, and damn, it's like, as I'm saying this, it's like, how can I say this in a room with a person who has had such a tremendous fight with the infrastructure of the city of Pittsburgh? When I say, it's almost fucked up, because when I say, I don't even want to say I love my city, like, kind of in front of you, because it's like, how can I say that when you had a Spartan type of war,
yeah,
with not the people but the infrastructure.
Yeah.
So it's like, this is the first time I've ever been checked about the city.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know if you, like, I think you watch me a little bit. I'm Pittsburgh proud.
But me too.
No, but I, like,
I love.
I think you're Pittsburgh proud, and I'm not trying to paint that narrative that you're not.
Right.
But it's like, you have valid points. Usually people just be like, oh, I hate Pittsburgh, people here, da 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 da. And like you and those people just be like, you're not really trying. Right. A lot of people that say they don't like Pittsburgh, they're not really trying. But for you,
Pittsburgh is evolving though, bro.
You fought like one of the craziest battles I've seen and came out on top, not only with your physical being, but your everyday battle, and we're gonna talk about that. Boy, I was watching some shit, and I was just like, damn, people don't get it. Right. Like, you said something in this one interview. You said, bro, you said, she said, so what, over the course of the years, what was some of your ha-ha moments? And you said, depression. And then you was like, and then I felt it, because you was just like, yo, depression's not like this hill that you climb, bro. Right. And then you get on top, and it's like, I'm good.
I done it.
Like, no, it's every day. Yeah. And then you went into specifics of you getting out of bed every day and how it's an everyday battle. And for me, my story was I've went through deep doubts of depression because I've lost my mother, my stepdad, and their son in a car accident on the way to my sister's wedding.
Wow.
So that kind of changed me. So when you was me and my little brother, so when you was speaking about that, I was just like, that's what it is. Right. It's every day, fam. Like, and I was just like, it's crazy. So when you speak about like, when I'm like saying I'm Pittsburgh proud or this, and this, it's like, but this city has got a deep under dark. And I started researching your, when I was looking at your Twitter, I was like, I want to see what he was saying when he was like a teenager.
Right.
But I kept going, and you smart motherfucker, it's only a certain point. I think you started your Twitter like 2017 or something like that.
Yeah,
like, fuck.
I deleted my old one.
Yeah, smart. Because I was, you know, I think I'm a journalist now. Michael Carroll, he's a journalist. So I go deep, pause, and when I'm looking at it, I see, one of the last things I see is like your conversations with the mayor. The tweets back and forth.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, there's some things that I don't know about this mayor.
Yeah, I don't rock with Petito.
Yeah, and I didn't know that. You know, for me, especially, you know, I left Pittsburgh when I was 18. Went to school out of Philadelphia, got my undergraduate at Cheney University, her first HBCU, and then got my master's at Westchester, then got into music. So I was out Philly for like 8 years. So when I came back like 5 years ago, you know, you hear about what's going on. I knew about your situation, but me being so self-involved in what I'm doing,
right.
You know, you don't really research or you don't really go into or deep dive into what's going on. So when I start researching your situation, when I see those tweets with the mayor, I'm like, there's some shit. There's some shit. I kind of want to go into, like, I think we got off topic, but I kind of want to go into, like, you said some things in, I think it was an article or interview, where the situation happened, and I think you wake up, and you're handcuffed.
Yep.
And I'm just like, I keep thinking about everything besides what happened. Like, I keep thinking about, like, that situation happened. But I keep thinking, like, how the fuck do you wake up and you're handcuffed?
Man, shock was it a bit, man.
Yo.
And my family couldn't visit me.
That's crazy.
For like 2 weeks.
Like, you don't got COVID. Like, you just.
It was
why couldn't they visit you?
Because I was under arrest.
In the hospital.
Yeah. So I woke up every day.
Boss.
Just look at an officer sitting in my room after I was shot by an officer. And I don't know, man, for a long time I had this hatred.
Yeah.
You know, just built up. And I think that a lot of the messages that I put out early on was different from how I felt.
Yeah.
Because I was really playing chess. Mm-hmm. I knew I couldn't be the angry black person.
Yeah.
Or I would just lose everything. Right. And so
How did you know that, though? And what made you think that? Like, was it advice or was it just, like, your own?
It was just my own. It was from, it was common sense for me.
Not for everybody.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen, like, you know, like the Trayvon Martin case that happened before I got shot, and just how they tried to, like, make him out to be this bad person.
Yeah.
And sway the jurors before the actual case.
Yeah.
So that's what I did.
Swayed him.
Yeah. Like, my lawyers were great, but I think it was really my smile and the fact that I was in the media at least every 2 or 3 months, at least once every 2 or 3 months.
Yeah.
For like 5 or 6 years, local or national media.
Yeah.
Without a publicist or anything, I just found different ways to frame my story and different things to do to get media attention to show the world that I was a good person.
It's simply amazing what you've been able to do over the course of 5, 6 years, 7, 8 years, honestly, 9. Yeah, I just was reading that. I think it was an article or video, and it was just like, he was handcuffed, and then I think you had your son, and you wasn't able to see him.
Yeah, so I was. My son was actually born in the same hospital.
Yeah. So you was recovering?
Yeah, I was on the 7th floor, I believe, and he was born on the 4th floor. So I was able to go downstairs.
Okay.
But I wasn't able to, like, go in the room.
Was you still, like, under arrest or?
No, at that point, no, I was in rehab.
Rehab.
Yeah, so, but I wasn't under arrest or anything.
Yeah. I remember reading, I'm like, damn, it was in the same hospital. How long after you were shot was your son born?
I was shot November 11th. 2012, and he was born January 1st, 2013.
Oh, he's a Capricorn. Yeah. I'm a Cap too, you real. You're a real one. That's what's up.
Yeah, so, yeah, it was a, it was a journey, bro.
No, listen, I can only imagine, and like, I keep talking about how I feel like I could relate to you, and I'm sure thousands of people in the world can. I'm not special. When you talk about, when you're in depression, there's only two ways that you can go. Bottom out, and sometimes you have to see the bottom. And we'll talk about like when you amass a large sum of money and how that actually makes everything way more complicated. Yeah. We'll get into that. I think that's something else I can relate to you too. But you talk about like putting on this smile,
right?
And I was in a place where like I was just like I just want to stay in my room for like. My apartment for like, I had like this condo. I just want to stay in my condo for like 3, 4 weeks, like a month, like I just not see anybody. But I knew the only way for me to get out of it was to act like I was progressing and put on this smile and this front and like this determination. And what it did for me in this positivity spin, like this positivity cap, and I practiced it. So I would walk into grocery stores and like be super nice to everybody.
Yeah.
All my friends, everyone I encountered, people I were dating. And the practice turned into, like, habit. And then, like, the habit turned into, like, something I enjoyed. And then I enjoyed it, and it turned into, like, my life.
Absolutely.
And I don't know, was that process kind of like that? I mean, when I listened to you talk about, like, how you was putting on a smile, but you was tired of it, but then it got you through, like, was it, like, a similar process for you, or was it, like...
Yeah, it was. But it started... The smile started back when, like, my sister passed.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. So it was like...
You was already used to it.
Yeah, getting shot and going through what I went through was... Couldn't even compare it to my sister passing away.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because it's like, I mean, I could, you know, take on pain, but to see your family hurting...
Yeah.
It's like, that's a different type of pain.
Yeah.
Right? And so I think that, you know, me losing my sister... Help prepare me for what I would go through with the city.
That's crazy. And I started talking to someone, and I was like, yo, I don't know if this interview is more for me or more for him. Because I lost my father when I was 16. And I think people like us, once again, the reason why I wasn't too, I don't want to say invested, but didn't do too much research on what was going on in your life at that time when I came into the city,
right,
is that I'm numb. Like, when you experience so much death, especially from where we come from, it's like, that's fucked up. Like, you'll say, like, yo, that's fucked up.
And you keep it pushing.
And
like it never happened.
That's fucked up.
Yeah.
Like, you start realizing, like, that dick is fucked up. Like, people come up to me and be like, you know, my peoples are going through this and my peoples are going through that. And I just be like, I'd be like, yo, that's like, I'm sorry. Like, yeah. for sure.
It's that trauma, bro.
It'll fuck you up.
Yeah. And it's like, I was just asked about the Ahmad story, the guy who was
bombing. Oh, yeah.
And I was like, yeah, I'm numb. Like, I expect.
Are you still numb? Or it's like, it
doesn't, bro. Unfortunately, it doesn't bother me, bro. Like,
but you see, and you know, so crazy.
I expect black bodies to die on camera, bro. It's like, I heard it and I seen it, and like, I'm not, I wouldn't.
It's even, not that we're not compassionate, but it's just like, I don't know, bro.
It's a weird reality to be a black American, bro, because we, like, even if you don't say you do, it's like death for me. It's like an expectation.
Yeah.
Like, somebody got shot by Target, and I was like, oh. I mean, I didn't even look to see what his name was, bro.
Yeah.
Like.
And it's like.
And I live, like, right down the street.
Yeah.
It was just like, damn, maybe I know, maybe I don't.
You know what's so crazy? Sometimes that numbness has led to so much success for me. Mm. Like, I've been able to push through so much shit because I'm not stuck on, like, this, and this. But sometimes there's other things that are unpacked that leads to that depression. And that's some of the things that I was just thinking about your story and, like, just your battle, like, from the time that you were shot to, like, you fighting the city and then you going up for... It was city council, man.
City council, yeah. That was fun.
Yeah, and I kind of like, because I was aware, and I think around this time I started, myself was evolving and dealing with my own depression and dealing with everything that was going on in my life. And as I was able to start dealing with things like that, I was able to start being more self-aware of what was going on in my environment. At that time, I started paying a little bit more attention to what you was doing. But what piqued my interest was, like, your story, and then you taking the fight to the city. And I kind of knew what it was already.
Right.
I thought it was fire. But I kind of want to talk about, like, how you were able to get through those 5-6 years from you. And you bulked up. Yeah. You got super bulky. Like, if you look at, like, old videos and old pictures versus, like, you now, it's like... Oh, he a grown man now.
Yeah,
I'm a grown man. He a grown man now. But, like, what was the things that you did during that time? And I'm assuming you were traveling the country giving speeches and talking to people and, like, helping people. And, like, you know, for me, my life kind of turned into helping people, too. Of course, not in your capacity, but, like, it was a selfish thing. I want to say me helping people turned into a selfish thing because the more I help people, the more it helped me.
Absolutely, and it's a coping mechanism.
Yeah.
Right? And so a lot of times, like, when we get over a hump, we look back at things that we did, and we're like, oh, I'm evolved, and I would have did things differently.
Yeah.
But it is, in fact, the things that you did during those seasons that got you to where you are now.
Yeah, and, I believe that, too.
And so, like just me smiling all the time when I wasn't happy on the inside helped me out. It, like, that was necessary because if it wasn't for that, I wouldn't been able to have the impact that I had on this.
Oh yeah, that's
community.
A fact.
And so I was speaking. You know, I wrote.
You wrote that book, Untold.
Untold.
Yeah,
I'll get you a copy.
I gotta read it.
Yeah. Just like, bro, I was in like cruise control, bro.
Yeah, like, it get like that.
I don't even remember a lot of like from being 19 to like now.
Yeah.
I don't really, it's like a blur.
Yeah, my shit is too.
Yeah, it's like a blur. And I was just responding and, you know, playing, you know, chess with life, bro. And my ultimate goal was to win.
You know what's so crazy? Like, I was at a point where, like, I was playing chess. Once again, everything I'm saying is a microcosm of the macro you went through.
Right.
But just like thousands of people could relate, I could relate in my own individual specific circumstances where, like, you was playing chess for 5 years. I was playing chess. I felt like I was playing chess for 5 years, and I got so burnt out of playing chess. The only recourse was, like, to bottom out or, like, just to start just being genuine. Right. And just like, I'm tired of playing chess with y'all niggas. And like, why do I have to play chess? Why is this need to win that's driving me insane?
Exactly.
And I just was like, it clicked for me. Like, my happiness is, I'm good at chess, but I'm way better at being genuine.
Exactly.
Like, I'm so much better at it. And I just started, like, everything, all the hate, I just started, like, embracing it with positivity. And, like, when I kind of look at, like, how you survived, that's something else that you said that was so dope. Someone was like, yeah, a victim of police brutality. He was like, I'm a survivor.
Yeah.
Like, I'm a survivor, fam. And I was just like, yeah, he's different. He's different.
And as a survivor, though, it's like, you know, it's a survivor of life.
Yeah.
Right? And a victim, it speaks to that one moment.
Yeah.
Right? And
it's you deal with it every day.
Yeah, every single day, bro. I have to make a conscious decision, you know.
To try.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's crazy. And so how many times did you think that you spoke to people during that, like in between the cases, you know, after you got shot? And I think the first time you spoke out loud, I want to say, was you said 2 years you did a protest.
Yeah.
That's when people started caring.
Absolutely.
What made you wait that long? And like,
bro, so I went from like being popular and like having all the girls and fighting every day to being in a wheelchair, bro. And I remember at the time, like,
shit was tough.
Yeah, because like I'm looking at people that I know I could beat up before. And I'm like, dang, a dude could just flip me out this chair right now. Like, you feel me?
Yeah.
Or even like just standing up face to face to another man making eye contact. Like,
yeah.
I'm looking up at people now.
Yeah. Right?
That didn't feel good, bro.
And yeah.
It just kind of like took my voice away. And
you had to restructure your mental and your soul?
Everything, bro. I had to, because my manhood was built on, you know,
a physical thing, physical structure.
Narrative, right? Yeah, just having more money, having more cars, having more women.
Yeah.
Right? And it's like, I mean, that's how it is in the neighborhood.
Yeah, that's how it is.
And then
you thought losing your legs destroyed, using the use of your legs destroyed that infrastructure that you had in your mind?
Yeah, because it didn't matter how much money, right? It was just like, bro, the main thing was like, yo, somebody could really flip me out this chair.
Yeah.
Right? And it just didn't feel good, bro. And so I started to read, bro.
Yeah.
Like, read, like, in the beginning, I would read, like, you know, black nationalist literature, bro. Mm-hmm. Like, real radical movements, bro. And that's the route
that's what got you out.
Yeah. And then from there, I evolved to more of, like, a mindfulness, like, reading, like, Eckhart Tolle.
Okay.
And that's like, because reading the black nationalist literature really made me so angry, and it didn't feel good on the inside, right?
So you had to level it out.
I had to level it out with mindfulness and strategy.
Yeah.
Right? And so I still had the force, right, mm-hmm. in the fight, but I was wise enough to make
channel
certain decisions.
Yeah.
That people on the outside may not have understood.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think when I like really like, and this is why I just started realizing, like, I wanted to know who you were before, because the way you moved and how you structure everything you say and the decisions you made have been simply fucking a joy to research and watch. And I'm not saying that your situation was a joy or like what you went through was a joy, but like how you handle it, I have never seen anything of that magnitude handled in such a way. And, like, even the first time I met you was with Levels Agency in Moreauville.
Oh, yeah, I remember
we were about to do the summer jam together. Yeah. And I remember just meeting you, and I knew of you. And I didn't understand what the meeting was for.
Yeah.
But I just was like, I'm coming. And just listening to you talk in that meeting, I knew there was something different about you.
Yeah, cause what was it? There was something.
I think you was gonna be a part. Like you was promoting, or like you was.
There was something with Black Lives Matter.
Oh yeah, they wanted to tie you in to the summer jam. You was doing a Black Lives Matter thing, but I think you declined. If I remember, they came back and said, "Mike, he declined. Yeah. He doesn't want to be involved." And it was a smart decision.
Yeah, I was never.
you know, we was trying to find any angle to get people in the building.
Yeah. But I was never like a I would collaborate and work with Black Lives Matter movement.
Oh, that's what it was. Yeah.
Yeah, but what
was that?
It doesn't make me feel good to like tell people that my life matters, bro. I just show up and you gonna respect me as a man.
So you had something against like their philosophies or
the messaging.
The messaging.
Yeah.
Yeah. I bet you so they approached you. They probably approached you and tried to get you on board. Here, I know you're about to structure some crazy political fucking answer, Leo.
No, but look.
Go ahead, think about it. I've seen you spin these interviews so fucking well, so go ahead. No, it's just really about, like, my life doesn't matter. This is what you're about to say.
No. But look, I don't know. So I had dealt with a lot of the mainstream activists.
Activists, yeah. Are they like? Are they that thorough like we thought they were, or are they fugazi?
There's a lot of black scholars that I grew up respecting, and I respect their philosophies and theories, but them as, you know, people, as, you know, men, it's just like...
What do you think about the guy? What's his name, man? He's super popular. Is it Umar?
Dr. Umar.
Yeah. What do you think about him? If you don't want to speak, you don't...
I like his...
His philosophy?
Yeah. I never really...
Got to meet him?
Yeah. No, I met him before. He seems cool. I know there's always like some things going on with him on social media. I never followed that stuff.
Yeah.
He seems like he cares, you know, but, you know, I don't know
him
too much.
Smart man.
You know, yeah. But the other... Like, I feel like if you don't die, most of them don't care, bro.
Yeah. And it's something else you said. Oh, that's just something else you said. You was like, So the reason why I'm unpacking my shit talking to you is because I want you to be open with me.
Right.
And the thing is, it's like I've seen you in so many places strategically like maneuver every situation.
Yeah, yeah.
That's like, yo, I want to get some real shit out of you.
All right, yeah.
So for me... I've had millions of dollars.
Right.
I was at the lowest point in my life. Mm. Right. And for me, it was like, it got to a point where I was like, I was doing so much for so many people and it seemed like they didn't care. Right. And you're giving yourself, and it's like, you're giving so much of yourself and it's like, it's not enough.
Right.
And there was points where like, I'd be in my Corvette top down, 5 a.m, driving. And like, yo, what would happen if I veered off and crashed into a car and died? What would happen if I just drove this $90,000 car over a bridge? How would they appreciate me after I was dead? Would they understand what I was doing now after I was dead? What would they say at my funeral? It would be beautiful at Mount Eric. I was in the Corvette Club. All the Corvettes would have pulled up. They would have revved. I thought about it. What would people say? And why wasn't they saying that now and treating me like shit after I'm giving my soul to these people?
Absolutely.
The reason why I related that to what you said something that was crazy. You said, and not crazy to me, but so relatable. You said, yo, I had to create an obituary and put it up and just to let people know, like, does it only matter if I was dead?
Right.
Like, does my case only matter? And I kind of want you to speak, like, what? Yeah. It's kind of like, I ain't going to lie to you, it's kind of like left.
Right.
So, and it's like, you created it. Like, I'm thinking, like, were you crying when you created it? Like, was it just a...
It was just, bro, every year, right, every year, I'm seeing these posts with, you know, people who died at the hands of police officers.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, he would have been 24 today.
Yeah.
He would have been, you know, 27, or she would have been 18. And so I was like, oh, I would have been dead.
Yeah. I would have been dead.
Like,
and was there a point, like, people wasn't, like, what was going on during that time that made you even respond that way?
Because, bro, you have to understand, I know, like, every mainstream person who talks about police brutality.
Yeah.
And it's frustrating because even at like like the marches and stuff. I know them.
Mm-hmm.
I've never spoken at none of the national marches. I never, my name never gets mentioned. Like my story.
Yeah.
It's like, even like right now, right? Like I sent, you know, my short film to a bunch of people, mm-hmm. right? And they're posting all mad every day. And it's so like, it makes people angry and upset. And it's so hopeless. Right?
Yeah.
Then there's this short film that's super put together well.
Yeah.
And it's very hopeful.
Yeah.
Like to give people something to hold on to, this, y'all, like, we can make a
change. We can beat it.
Yeah.
We can make a stand. Here's a guy who went through it and is still being positive and progressing and highlighting mental health.
Exactly. So it just doesn't click to me why, you know, these individuals, like, won't support, right?
Yeah.
Publicly. They respect
it. Have you speculated why?
One of the things that I've always thought about is that I mean, it's like hip hop, bro.
Yeah.
Like being like an activist, quote unquote activist, it's like being a rapper. We get paid lots of money to speak at universities, bro.
Yeah.
Right. And so, you know, if attorney Benjamin Crump, right, you know, if he could speak on behalf of his dead clients and get paid $25,000, $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 to speak for an hour at a university, why would he lift up my voice?
Yeah.
Now that's taking money out of it.
So it's politics and money.
It is politics and money, bro.
And that makes everything like corny as fuck.
Bro, Benjamin Crump used to be my lawyer, bro.
Yeah.
And I called him when I was running for city council. And I was like, yeah, I'm running for city council. And I'm just, you know, reaching out to see if I could count on you for a donation.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, you had a settlement, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah. He's like, oh, you don't need my money. You don't need my money. Meanwhile, bro, I got the computer up, bro.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm saying he donated like $8,000 or $10,000 to like Hillary Clinton's campaign. Like, bro, all these campaigns, I'm looking at all the money that he donated, bro.
Yeah.
And I'm like, it just doesn't make sense, bro.
That's crazy as fuck.
Yeah, it doesn't make sense. So, yeah, a lot of those individuals, man, it's like, and that's why I don't really get, like, you even challenged me to use social media.
Yeah,
more.
That's when we kind of like reconnected after all those years.
But I really like that, the energy and me understanding the politics behind people's platforms and, you know, me questioning, like, are these people really authentic? Do they really care about this issue? Or are they posting about the issue for more clicks?
Mm-hmm.
And if they get more clicks, they get more follows. And mm-hmm. if they get more
which leads monetary.
They get more speaking engagements.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And so me, it's just like, I care about the messages going out, bro.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I haven't done a speaking engagement in like a year and a half, 2 years.
Why is that?
I just got tired of it, bro. Like,
yeah.
Oh, I was shot, you know. I want to talk about solutions, and people, a lot of people want to hear the story about what happened. They're so intrigued about what happened that night.
Yeah.
And it's like, bro, there's so many other solutions and different things that I'm doing to prevent that from happening again.
Yeah.
Like, this is what I want to talk about.
Right.
Right? I want to empower, you know, these students to run for office and to become lawyers and to become lobbyists, right?
Mm-hmm.
To change some laws. And even, you know, encouraging people to become police officers, right? And,
yeah. They're not all bad.
Yeah, no, they're not all bad, bro. Because, brother, honestly, there was a lot of police officers who helped me out behind the scenes.
That's crazy.
Yeah, it's like,
I never knew that.
Yeah. There's a lot of...
Is there any... I know you can't say names, but, like, is there anything in particular that you could say they did, or... And I'm guessing we're talking about the Pittsburgh police. If you can't, then it's
cool. Yeah, I wouldn't, you know, but...
But they helped you. There were some police officers that helped you.
Significantly.
And, you know, they're human beings as well, but positive and negative.
Yeah. And it's like, the more we could have... And even, like, think, like, this is one... plan that I had in regards to gentrification, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you got like these young people, they don't know what they want to do after high school.
Mm-hmm.
You feel me? A lot of them, you know, they're into activism now. They want to mentor the young people and stuff. So I'm like, yo, why not just go, you know, get your credits? I think it's like maybe like 60 or 80 credits that you need to become a police officer.
Something like that.
Get these credits. Become a police officer.
Because my brother was looking into it.
Right? And you can make a decent amount of money and have good benefits.
Yeah, I think it's like 50,000 or 60,000.
Yeah,
or something like
and
that.
Then I was even thinking about if there was a program where we partner nonprofit organizations with like some churches, with the city of Pittsburgh and the local universities, right? Mm-hmm. So I do a lot of work with Duquesne University.
Duquesne's great.
Yeah, I like Duquesne. So for instance, we do some type of project where the nonprofit, and we have some very solid nonprofit foundations in Pittsburgh, right?
Yeah.
Heinz Pittsburgh, you know, Foundation, the Forbes Fund. So just imagine
Advancing Black Arts.
Exactly. Well, that comes from the
Forbes.
Heinz,
okay.
Heinz,
okay.
Right. So these foundations gives hundreds of millions of dollars, probably billions of dollars a year collectively. So what if they created a fund where they pay for these young people
to
become police officers?
Yeah.
Then the city, right, because of there's gentrification, the city allocates a percentage of the homes in these neighborhoods that's being gentrified for those new recruits to buy. So now they become homeowners.
At low interest rates or whatever they need.
Exactly,
yeah.
Right? Because then we could loop in the banks.
Yeah,
right?
Loop in the banks, yeah.
So it's like
the URA would step right in, like, what's up?
Bro, that is a solution, bro.
It's a real solution.
It's a real solution. You know what I'm saying? But
you can still get it done, too, if you wanted to.
I realized, yeah. Yeah, for
That's
sure.
That's something else I want to talk to you about. Like, I know you don't want to speak, and I get it. Like, I said at the beginning of the video, I don't even want to talk about exactly what happened.
Right.
Because I know you're tired of talking about it. I watched interviews for 7 years on you.
Right.
Bro, I didn't go to sleep. No lie. Do I look tired? I didn't go to sleep till 8 o'clock this morning.
Wow.
And the only reason why I first want to go to sleep is because I have a workout in Verona at 2 o'clock, which I'm probably going to be late for. I'm going to push it back to 2:30 because I don't want to be super tired walking up hills with weights.
Right.
If it wasn't for that, I wasn't going to go to sleep. And what I did was I just kept rolling around the bed and I just watched everything. Bro, that's all people want to know about. What happened during that night? Motherfucker, watch the video.
Right.
And all you do is watch one interview. I say I have to say, like, you got a voice. And, like, the fact that, like, I know these engagements want to hear, they're more interested in wanting to hear about what happened versus solutions. And for me, it was like, I wanted to know how you were able to get through it. So I want to know about your childhood and your teenage years. And I want to know after. But you have a voice. And that's when we talk about the social media stuff when you was traveling. And this is, like, when I first started becoming interested in really doing a real interview on you.
Right.
Because, and it was the same thing with Chuck Sanders. I heard something negative about him. Like, someone said, oh, you see this article, he said he raped this, or he sexually assaulted this girl, or he's covering up money or something. And I read the article, then I looked at the source.
And it was that real.
It wasn't a real article, and that's when I started making moves. And I said, I want to know your story. Like, because I know, the reason why I'm so curious when people talk about people negatively is that 9 out of 10 times I don't know what the fuck they're talking about.
Right.
And it's happened to me so fucking much.
Chuck's a good dude.
Chuck's a super good dude.
He shows a lot of love.
And that was like one of the reasons why, like, I interviewed him. And you'd be surprised what I learned during that interview about him. And somebody said something negative about you. Or I heard something. Or I seen something. It just something clicked in me. It was after you left.
Right.
And that's when we start talking DMs. I'm like, yo, social media, bro. And the reason why I say that and I'm so big on it is because my name was, and it's still to this day, and once again on a micro level, you're macro, I'm micro, my name was just being dragged through the streets. And there was a narrative being created about me that I just didn't like.
Right.
And the way I battled it, and the way I continue to battle it, is by telling my story. And, like, you have the talent of writing books, and I haven't tackled that talent yet, But like my hieroglyphs and like my cave stone walls have been like Instagram and Facebook and Twitter.
Word.
And like telling my story like daily and like making mistakes while I tell it. And people respond to that. And like, that's why like when you was traveling and like we were talking, I was just like, yo, bro, like just talk. Like whatever. Like talk about your food, talk about your feelings, talk about like the sunset, like. And like you started doing it a little bit, and like you as much as comfortable as you were able to do.
Right.
And when you was doing it, it was, and every time, bro, every time you speak or write, it's beautiful.
Appreciate it.
And like, I think it was like that before you got shot, and I think it got enhanced after.
Right.
Through struggle and the natural effect of time, we either get better or we get worse. But bro, like. You're eloquent with your words, bro. Like when you talk, when you write those posts, when you paint those pictures, it's amazing.
Appreciate
and then
it.
You was able to put it into like a, I think it was like 10 minutes. It's too short. Leon's too short, bro. Like, I'm sorry, bro. It's just too short. And I guess we'll get to that. Yeah. But
we're gonna work on some, you know.
It's so I wanted the before. Like it's so good though.
Yeah.
That's why. Like I'm hoping someone sees it and be like, all right, let's put some more money behind it.
So
it's coming. Oh, let's go.
Yeah, so hold on.
It's coming. The announcement here on 1,000 Eyes.
Leon was actually supposed to be about my campaign, bro.
So let's get into it. Let's unpack it. Go ahead. Right,
so this is what happened. In February of 2019.
Why did you want to run? Like, well, honestly. You just wanted to beat the city.
Yeah.
Like, fuck Bill.
Yeah.
Like, I'm gonna work my way up.
That was like a middle finger, bro. Like,
I'm gonna work my way up, and like, I already know.
But the idea came, though. Like, I gave this speech downtown, like, after Antoine Rose passed.
Yeah.
And like, everybody was going crazy on social media, like, yeah, Leon Ford for mayor. And I was like, well, I'm not gonna run for mayor because I don't really know too much about politics.
But I can run for
city. Like, bro, I don't think, even now, nobody could beat me in
you would've won.
District 9.
I think you would've won.
Absolutely. Bro, District 9 is Garfield.
You would've won.
East Liberty, Larmer.
5 years, you would've been mayor.
Lincoln, East Hills.
5 to 10, you would've been mayor.
Right, it's all the neighborhoods where all my family's at. Like,
you would've won.
Yeah, it was just.
I think it would've been an easy layup.
It was.
But I'm guessing, and this is some things I think you haven't revealed, and I want you to kind of talk about it.
Because,
you know, of course, I don't know too much about politics, but what, like, I love TV shows and movies.
Yeah.
Like, I watch everything that's fire. And when you look at politics, immediately what I'm thinking of why you dropped out was because of the reasons that you spoke about.
Right.
Right? But also, I feel like you dropped out, at my own speculation, I feel like they were probably fucking with you. And I did some little research, and I'm not even going, you know what?
Yeah.
I'm not even going to speak on it, but I seen some things that they were trying to attack you on some administrative things.
Yeah.
And I seen that, and I was like.
I had to fire my whole team.
Yeah.
Yeah. But so the thing, like, let me back up.
Yeah.
So I went to a meditation retreat in Mexico
mm-hmm.
with like a bunch of like.
I remember you told me about this.
CEOs and founders and. Like very powerful people.
Yeah.
And they were basically telling me like, yo, like, why do you want to be like this fish in a pond?
Yeah.
Like you belong in the ocean. Like,
yeah.
Like that's too small for you. Like, and you can do
the
so
politics.
Much great things. Yeah. And so, and I already had it in my, like this gut feeling like, yeah,
it's not
really
for me.
I want to deal with these people.
Yeah.
You know?
It's dirty.
It is dirty. And so when I came back to Pittsburgh, I was just like depressed because I knew I didn't want to run. But then I was seeing all my signs in everybody's yard.
Yeah, I remember you was talking about that.
And like people were like, yo, Leon, we got your back, right? And how do I tell these people that I don't want to run for city council? And so at one point I was just like, well, I'm not even just going to push my campaign and maybe I'll lose. But then I was like, damn, I might still win. If my name's on the ballot, I'll probably still win. And so I already had, like, paid.
The camera.
The camera.
And that's a good director. I did my research. He did, like, a Meek Mill documentary and anything.
Yeah, they're dope, man.
Yeah, they're dope.
So, and they were like, yo, you know, you can set up this campaign event. so we could film there. And I didn't do anything like we talked about, bro. Mm-hmm. And so they were blowing me up. I ghosted them.
Yeah.
And they ended up hitting me up like, bro, like, we care about you. You know what I'm saying? Like, whatever you're going through, we're still going to come.
Yeah.
Because you are our friend.
Like, yeah. That's dope. You know?
Yeah, it was like super genuine. And they came to Pittsburgh and we didn't have no plan, bro. We were just filming anything.
I peeped that.
Right. And I was just like, y'all need to go to see a therapist, y'all. Like,
yeah.
Something's not right.
Yeah.
So I made the appointment and they were like, you mind if we film it? And I was like, yeah, just call her. Like, this is her number, bro. I'm not doing anything, bro. Yeah. I'm overwhelmed with life.
Yeah.
And they reached out to her and set it up and they filmed it. And
that shit was fire.
Yo, it just turned like
it was amazing.
We didn't thank you, bro. We did not know what this film was going to be.
They put that together. And like, I felt that therapy session. It was super dope. And, yeah. Like, the decision, like, you made the decision right there in the room.
Right. And, it, like, when I said it, like, when we had that breakthrough, the room was, they were just like,
Oh, shit. You're not running.
Yeah, it was like, yeah, it was, that was the moment. Like, that was history, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm so grateful.
I choose me.
It was captured on that
on
camera.
The film. Yeah.
Because... Bro, that was life-changing, bro. Like, I would be a city councilman right now, stressed out.
Yeah.
Right? And
that's not what you wanted.
Exact. And that was the moment, like, you mentioned this, where you said, like, at one point you had to make a decision not to play chess and just be authentic.
And be genuine. Yeah.
Yeah, and that was my moment.
What do you really want out of life? Like, what makes you happy?
That was my moment, bro. Like, yo, let me just be me.
I wanted, you know what I wanted to see after, like, you made that decision? And they were talking. I wish they would have went to Europe with you.
I know.
That shit would have been so fire. You wheelchairing through Europe. That shit would have been fire. You happy as hell. I would have been like,
yo,
I just kept thinking like, I want so much. Then what's next? And then I started thinking like, what is next?
Yeah. So right now, like over the past year, I've just been building my team, bro. From my financial advisor to business manager to entertainment attorneys, mm-hmm. like just get agents, you know, and managers, like mm-hmm. just getting all these pieces in order
mm-hmm.
because I had, you know, so many opportunities on the table, but there wasn't no captain, right? There were certain things that I just didn't know how to move forward with. And so now I got, you know, a solid, solid team in place
okay.
to help me, you know, navigate these spaces. And
Leon, stop with your bullshit.
What's up?
Stop with your bullshit, bro.
What you mean,
I understand, bro? You got a team. That's so fire.
Yeah.
What the
yeah.
fuck is next, nigga? What's next? Tell me, like, yo, because I'm dying to know.
Yeah, so there's a possible TV series.
Okay, that's fire.
The script is done.
Did you have hands writing in it?
It was a bunch of my ideas.
Okay.
Yeah,
that's
like
dope.
Different ideas, and you know, I definitely contributed.
Yeah, that's dope.
But like, there was two other writers who are super dope, and it's dope because I feel like I just got a free education, bro.
Yeah.
Like to really like sit in a room and talk to people who are able to take my ideas
mm-hmm.
and create something amazing. Bro.
That's crazy.
Right. So now.
Can we speak on the writers? Are they like, have they worked on other projects?
Yeah, they've worked on other projects.
Like, can you give me give me an example of like a project that we might know of? Or is there projects that we might know of that
Scandal.
They worked on? Scandal? Oh, you're working on something big.
Yeah, it's so we'll see what happens.
I mean, the reason why I asked is because, you know, me and my brother are the opposite. Like,
right.
We handle the tragedy differently. So for me, it's like nonstop progression and work and like, you know, trying to accomplish whatever I want to do at that particular moment.
Right.
And for him, it's like, well, why don't you smell the flowers, Mike?
Right.
And at first I hated that about him. Like, bro, like, what are you doing? And he's like 5 years younger than me. So I was just being the big brother overzealous, like, yo.
Let's go.
Like, rocking.
But there's a balance.
But then, yeah, as I got older, I started realizing, like, well, maybe what I'm doing is unhealthy and what he's doing is healthy.
Yeah.
And so I apply that to you where it's like, I kept thinking, like, what's next? Like what's next? What's next with him? And then maybe it's
the flowers are my creativity, bro.
Yeah.
Like I literally like leverage my low moments to create, and that's when I create the best stuff, bro. The best content.
Me too.
And I've learned how to take myself on a roller coaster. Mm-hmm. Like instead of just waiting for that depression to hit me, yeah. Like I'll literally be in like a room and I'll take myself there, feel it,
and then use
create,
it. Me too.
And come out of it.
Yeah, it's and I try to explain to him like I love what I do, bro. Absolutely. Like every single thing, I love it, and it helped me, bro. And I meet so many people doing it, bro. And like I learn so much from it. And it, like once again with the social media stuff, like I was looking at, you know, I'm doing research on everything last night, and I was looking at your Twitter and I looked at your Instagram, and I seen something you said, social media fasting, in your yeah. in your joint. I was, and you know, I got pissed. I was like, fuck no. But the reason why I say that is because, is it the toxicity of social media that you don't like?
I don't like social media, bro.
At all.
I'm not like. One of my goals is, like, as I evolve as a writer
yeah.
and create, whether it's films or TV or literature, mm-hmm. like, my goal is to, like, so there's two types of, like, writers. There's, like, the writers who are, like, always on the road mm-hmm. and, you know, they're on social media. Mm-hmm. And then there's the writers that's just creating and people don't even know where they are.
That's true. Same with music.
Yeah. Same with like, music. I wanna be that person, bro. Like
okay.
I wanna be with my son on a beach, bro.
Yeah.
Writing.
Yeah, I understand.
And like and I get the self made own all your stuff. I yeah. get that. But I'd rather write and have the machine push it out.
Yeah.
And I'm done with it, bro. Like,
yeah.
I'll get my royalties.
Yeah, I understand that. Right. And stay away from, like, the headaches.
Yeah, because ultimately, man, when you get to a certain level, it's like people, you go to college so you can have a good job. You get a good job so you can buy a house and provide for your family.
Yeah.
So that you can retire. And if you have the ability to, like, be free.
Yeah.
I don't, that's like, I tell my dad all the time, like, I don't want to, I'd rather invest in that. Own a, like a business or like micromanage people.
Yeah.
Because I don't like micromanage people.
Yeah. Like, yeah, it sucks.
I don't want that responsibility.
Yeah.
I just rather make my money, bro. And
yeah.
and I know what my budget needs to be. I know how much money I need to make and I know what I can afford and I live within my means. And I'm free, bro. Like that freedom yeah. of like not like I can take 2 years off.
Yeah.
Right? And just find myself.
That's dope.
And that freedom, bro, I wouldn't give that up for, ooh. You know,
yeah.
millions of dollars, bro. It just
yeah.
doesn't mean anything.
I think the little bit that you have shared via social has helped me. Appreciate and like I know the things that you have shared and like your short film and your books and whoever consumes like literature, whoever consumes social media, whoever consumes docu-films, documentaries, each individual piece, I think, has impacted people. And, like, I love you telling your narrative because I know how it is, like, just being in a position where, like, you know, everybody's trying to paint a certain thing about you. And, like, when you left, how you took the money and quote-unquote ran, or you quote-unquote did this, or you should have ran for city council. And I just thought that was corny.
Man.
And, like, the little bit of stuff you did talk about while you were away, like, it wasn't, like, fuck what people think, but at the same time, it was like, this is what I'm doing, bro.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
And you gotta choose you.
Choose you. Yeah, it's always about, and then once you, like, start realizing, like, I don't give a fuck about what no one thinks, everybody loves it. Yeah, man, like, I can't wait to hear more about the TV show.
Yeah. I'll tell you more of it after the cameras are off.
Leon, like, I thank you so much for coming to the Thousand Eyes podcast.
Appreciate you,
I think this interview really, like, gave me a whole nother perspective on you and kind of, like, changed my life. And I think your story, like, I think my final takeaway is your story is so much more than what happened that night.
Absolutely.
It has a lot to do with who you were before, and has everything to do with who you became after. And I love how you refuse to be a tool that was used in people's minds to uplift whatever they had going on in their own lives.
Right.
And I love to choose me and be free. And I think you're an amazing individual. And I don't know what you'll end up doing or how you'll end up doing it, but I'm positive you'll be great in it.
Appreciate that, bro.
Real shit. So thank you so much for coming on. We're here at Studio Me. They're kicking me out, so
yeah.
I'm out of here. Thanks,
all right. Thanks, bro. Yeah. Appreciate you, man.
Real stuff.